The following is a production of DallasCowboys.com and the Dallas Cowboys Football Club.
How about them Cowboys?
Yeah! Go Cowboys!
This is Cowboys Storyline with Nick Eatman.
Hello and welcome to Cowboys Storyline. I am Nick Eatman. It is time to talk Cowboys football. Give you guys an opportunity to talk Cowboys football. You can call in on the show, 888-855-2297. Talk about this Cowboys team, upcoming game against the Detroit Lions, and also this last game against Pittsburgh. It was wild and crazy. Definitely worth looking back and talking about that one. And also the fact that, you know, we're just where this Cowboys team is right now after five games of the season. I say it all the time, it's a roller coaster. It's up, it's down, and that's what this season has been. They won the first one against Cleveland. Looked like this was going to be one of those years where, you know, they had a really dominant team, especially on defense. And then two games hit, New Orleans and Baltimore, humbled a lot of people, the team, fans, all that. And wondering now what this team is really about. Are we starting to look at the draft show? Blah, blah, blah. And then comes the Giants game, tough, hard-fought win. And then Pittsburgh was you know, another one of those type of games. And so, you know, they're 3-0 on the road and 0-2 at home. And here comes the Lions coming to town this weekend. Should be a lot of fun to talk about that. All right. Let's get going here on the phone lines. Our first caller is from Oklahoma, Curtis in Ada, Oklahoma. Curtis.
Good morning.
How are you doing?
Excellent, man. How are you?
I'm great. What's up with you?
That's good. Man, I just thought that was a crucial win. You know, I'm the guy that called in a couple weeks ago and was like, well, maybe we kind of tank, maybe we try to trade and, you know, see where we're at the end of the season. But that's just because of where we were in the season and looking at our schedule. And, I mean, our schedule is brutal, but, you know, we got to – I mean, if you look at the three possibilities, if we lose the next two games, we're kind of back down. We've lost two conference games. If we go 1-1, okay, we're right there in the middle. But if we can find a way to win these next two games, man, I mean, that's almost – I'm back to we're going to go to the Super Bowl type of vibes, you know. So just really important games coming up, especially the 49ers haven't been what they've been previously. So maybe this might be one of your good shots after the bye week to really, you know, close the case on that and get you a win in the win column. Because, you know, the last couple of years, it's just been kind of brutal going up against the boombox 49ers. But a couple of things that I wanted to talk about the Steelers game is I seen what's called like the orbit motion. Do you know what that is?
The guy goes back, like
he goes in motion and like doubles back in this big orbiting satellite route. Yeah. And I really love that we've incorporated that motion, especially when you talk about guys like Kevontae Turpin, because you get to see who's following them. And then when they double back, they have like a full head of steam when the ball's hiked, and it gives us a lot of speed out there on the edge. And those short passes kind of become an extension of the running game. And I think we really need that. I know Rico Dowdle has come on in these last couple weeks. I have him on my fantasy squad, and I can see the points that he's generating, and so I know that he's putting in production, also receiving touchdowns out of the backfield. So okay. I really like that. And I think our defense is starting to kind of figure it out with the getting the rush up front and how to work the zone. We worked man for so long, and maybe it's because Trayvon was the only one that really carried over from that system, and so maybe these other guys getting in there has lent to that. And but I thought there was a few opportunities where we were good at the run, but we could have been even better. I thought we had Harris and Fields in the backfield, and they were just really wiggly, which, you know, a lot of starters are, but it could have been an even better day for the run. So I'm just excited, man, to look forward to these next couple games, and hopefully we can get two wins and everybody be flying high after that.
All right. Sounds good. Let's keep it going. I didn't see a lot of questions there from Curtis, just some comments, which is great. Let's go to Lester in Minnesota.
Hey, Nick, how you doing this morning,
good.
Man?
What's up? How are you?
Hey, I was the one that called in last week and said we need to have a good offensive and defensive line to build a team from there, but I know we're going already. So I got one question for you before I give my little take here. Have you heard anything about Austin Richards? What's going on with him?
He's the backup tackle, and he played as a they brought him in as a tackle eligible extra blocker, so he's kind of your swing tackle, but he's not. It definitely seems like him playing left tackle and keeping Tyler Smith at guard is not a better option than moving Tyler Smith to left tackle and T.J. Bass at guard. So maybe where he is Bass is a better guard than he is a tackle, and it seems like Tyler Smith can play both at the high level, which should not be overlooked how great and important that is. Sorry, Lester, you got another comment?
Yeah, I was just thinking about putting Austin Richard at right tackle and taking Steele out, because Steele, I don't know what's going on with him. I'm not saying he's doing a bad job, but he's on the run block, he's great, but on the pass block, he gets beat. And I know he had an injury a couple years ago. I'm sorry, but it just seems like he's not holding up the pass very well, pass block. Also, I said the score for the Pittsburgh game would be 21-17. It was 20-17, so I was close. I've been watching that a long time. Like I said, all my family from Pittsburgh, so I know where they usually come to. We need to win the next two games. I think we should keep running the ball, man, because the line was better with Bass at guard and Tyler at left tackle, and I would put Austin Richard over there, if he's ready. I'm not sure if he's ready, but I know he can pass block better than Steele. And then I'll hang up and listen.
All right. Well, this is what this show is all about. Give a fans an opportunity to throw in their opinions on how they see things. We don't have to agree. And this is not one where I agree. I do not think that Austin Richard is as good a blocker as Terrence Steele. A pass, run, anything, honestly. I don't think that's the case. Now, that's nothing against him. He's a young, developing player that hasn't gotten a lot of opportunity. Terrence Steele was a young lineman at the same spot now. I mean, remember, Terrence Steele was undrafted. Austin Richards was fifth-round pick. After his first year, even in his second year, there wasn't a lot of people saying how Terrence Steele was going to be this great tackle. Well, he kept getting better and better because they had to. They didn't have a lot of choices. He had to play, and that helped him. And he got a huge contract, and you know, and this is a guy that they've committed some money to, so they're not taking him out. Yeah, he gives up some plays. I mean, they do. I mean, that's what happens. I mean, look at the guys that they've gone up against here, and you know, if he's getting beat by T.J. Watt, he's not the only one. I mean, that happens. Again, I think Terrence Steele is a solid player. I don't think he's going to be a Pro Bowl type guy. I don't see that happening. But I do think he's a really good player, and he's getting better and better. And you know, I'm not changing that for Austin Richards. I mean, they just made the point. I mean, they needed a left tackle. Their left tackle went down in the game. They moved the guard out there. I think that just kind of goes to show where things are with Austin Richards. But that's, you know, that's fine. He's ahead of Willetsko. He's ahead of Josh Ball. He's ahead of those guys. You know, he beat them out as the swing tackle, but I don't think he was involved in their best options there. But he's still, they put him in for an extra blocker, and he's a young player, needs to develop. I don't know about changing him now for Terrence Steele. I think you still ride with Terrence Steele. All right, let's go to Ali in Florida.
Good morning, Nick.
Good morning. How are you?
Pretty good, buddy. I'm so happy for you, and I'm going to tell you why. First of all, I got a few comments, and a shout out, then I hang up and listen. First, I want to give you a shout out to you and Chris for being such a big boy and show off yesterday after the late delay. I said there is no way they're not going to cancel the show, but you stood and made the day.
Yeah, thank you.
Second, I was so happy for your Razorback. My whole life, I never watched them, ever. I was, you know, I'm a first responder. I do photography stuff, all the natural disaster. I was with a group of Floridian search and rescue team. They were watching, preparing for this hurricane coming to Tampa. And they said, what the hell are you watching the Razorback? I said, man, I have one of my dear friends. He's from Arkansas. He's just like, I was rooting for, I couldn't be more happier for you. Seriously, thank you. From the bottom of my heart. And then your Cowboys win, my Cowboys as well. And I love the game, the way it was like an old NFC East punching and punching back, like an old Parcells era. Loved it. And I just want to make sure, say a prayer for all the Floridians that are in the path of this hurricane. Hopefully this thing goes away. But love you, brother.
All right.
You're awesome.
Thank you.
Thank you for what you do.
Thank you so much. Appreciate that. Yeah, we weren't canceling the show. There's no doubt about it. I mean, if we cancel one, we got to cancel all of them, right? So we're not doing that. We just got to suck it up. Like you said, when we did, credit to Chris Beam, the producer, did a great job. You know, another credit to, and thank you also to, like, that. I've always said this. This is how you know you have a true friend, okay? There's two things. When you've got a team, do your friends, do they call you and say, you know, like, are they rooting against your team so they can laugh and kind of, you know, give you crap for it? Or do they root for your team just for you? That's when you know a good friend is. And when I think about that, some of my best friends, they will text me that they don't really, you know, they don't love Arkansas Razorbacks, but they do because of me. That's what a true friend is. Then, you know, you got the flip side too, the ones that will text or call, but they better not text me because I don't handle that well. Anyways, thank you, Ali. And I will say this too about Chris Beam, because I've had a few people that have messaged me about this. I don't know if you guys saw this, okay? Before the game on Sunday Night Football, I guess it's football in America, it was before the game because it was during the delay, they put on the screen, they put a tweet of mine. I've never seen them do that before. I guess I don't watch the show. I don't watch the pregame show. But they put the tweet before the game. I tweeted out a video of the players, the coaches, were working on wet ball tricks. Drills. They put the ball in the water and thrown it to the tight ends. Linda Wells was doing that. Got the video, put it out, said they're preparing for the rain. They put that on the TV screen. I look at my phone. I've got like 25 messages like, oh, my God, big time, blah, blah, blah. Truth be told, that really wasn't even my video. Chris took the video. Chris gave it to me, knew I had a little bit more followers than him. So he said, why don't you tweet it out? I tweeted it out, and it makes national TV where Jason Garrett is talking about it. Ironically, my picture is so old and outdated, I actually look like I have red hair. I actually look like Jason Garrett. Maybe it's time for a change there. A lot of irony going on in that. So thank you, Chris, for picking me up yet again. All right, Zach in Atlanta.
Hey, what's up, Nick? How are you?
What's up, man? How are you?
Doing all right, man. It's been, I guess, a week or two since I called in. But, man, Sunday was fun. Wasn't pretty. We talk about the roller coaster analogy a lot, and man, this season just seems like a roller coaster that you're thankful it gets back to the station. You know, the wheels didn't fall off completely. Nobody died. Maybe somebody threw up, but just seems like it's going to be that kind of season, especially
with
all the injuries. You know, and I feel like this season, more than in recent memory, I'm just saying, hey. You know, are we going to be setting the league on fire? Probably not, but a fun win against the Steelers, all the drama at the end, you know, Dak almost fumbling out of the end zone on the pylon, and then
that,
another fumble.
You know what? That play's not getting talked about.
That's what I'm saying, yes.
But if that ball goes a couple inches forward and hits
That's
that
game.
Pylon, game. You're right.
Yeah.
100%
I mean,
right.
All of the drama. So it wouldn't be a Cowboys-Steelers game without it. But
true.
Yeah, man, just trying to lean into the game-to-game approach and enjoying each game because who knows how many more wins we'll have. But, you know, if we can build some character here, put together some strong performances and get some wins, you know, reinforcements are on the way. We didn't lose.
Yeah.
Tank or Micah for the season. Marshawn Nealon looks like he's coming coming back in a few weeks. Same with Deron Bland.
Yeah, Mike.
You know, maybe this running game is finding its way. Maybe, you know, we have something in Tolbert, and we're using Turpin, and you know, maybe we find enough to say, all right, now when the other guys come back, we have a more competitive team than we thought at the season start. Okay. So,
all right,
that's what I'm saying. Right. And yes, sir. And then the last note I have, I like to kind of, you know, look at who's played for the Cowboys and then our opponent. And so looking back at Sunday against the Steelers, Chaz Green did a stint on the Pittsburgh roster. And I'm just curious, what was that after game like when he had his performance against the Falcons? Like, do you approach the guy? Is nobody wants to talk to him? Just curious about what that was like that fateful day. And so with that, I'll hang up. Take care.
Cool. Yay. Didn't think we'd talk about that one. But yeah, we are going to go back to Atlanta here on November the 3rd. Zach, I would imagine you're going to try to make your way there to the game. But Chaz Green game, you know, we talk about that. Like, that's even been discussed as a potential documentary, not Chaz Green, but a documentary on the name game, the Jason Garrett game, the Miles Austin game, the Emmett game, the D. Ware. Unfortunately, it goes the other way, too. You know, I mean, there is the Chaz Green game. What I remember about that at the end of the game, and if you don't remember, it was 2017. That seems too long ago for that. But it was back there, 2018 or 19, against the Falcons. And he gave up like 7 sacks in the game to Adrian Claiborne. Is that his name? I mean, it was unbelievable. And they didn't give him a lot of help. They should have. I remember him talking after the game. And, you know, this was a third-round pick. They expected much better things from. Didn't work out, of course. I know the game was like 27-7. I remember that. I can't remember the score of the year. Maybe it was 2018 or 17. I don't know. 2017. There you go. Chaz Green game. He's bounced around, I guess, the league a little bit. Didn't work out here. Let's hope for nothing like that again, ever. All right, and Dak would appreciate that. All right, Randy in Texarkana is next.
Morning, nephew. How you doing?
Good. How are you? Texarkana, Arkansas. I will point that part out.
There you go. Well, I'm a Texas boy, so let's just either way, we're good.
Oh, okay. Texas.
Yeah. I just happen to live in Arkansas.
Texas.
So, observation. All right, I've heard coaches and players talk about this on defense, and this goes to why the defense looked so good against Pittsburgh. They were playing team defense. And what I mean by that is when Micah Parsons is on the field, they tend to plan their defense around him. They design their defense around Micah, what they're going to do with him, where they're going to line him up, and all that. Well, if the offense figures him out and they take him out of the game, that screws up the plan for all the other guys, and it's almost like they're having to wing it. I think they should not plan around Micah anymore, just play simple team defense, and just let him be a good player on that defense.
Hmm.
You get what I'm saying?
Kind of. You're saying don't let him float around?
It's not that. It's don't pinpoint him in the plan of your defensive scheme. Because if they mess up that part of the defense, then it throws off the rest of the defense. If they figure out a way to take Micah out of the game, well, you've planned that particular defense for Micah. And if they take him out, well, then it blows the rest of it.
Yeah.
So if they'll just pretend like Micah's not Micah anymore and just have a game plan of across-the-board defense like they did against Pittsburgh and just let him be a really good player on that defense, they may make, you know, it may wind up being better. I don't know. It's just a thought I had. That's
There's two
I've
sides.
I've heard him make that comment.
All right, Randy. Anything else? I have a comment on that.
Yeah, no, that's it.
That's it?
Well,
all right.
Yeah, that's it.
Well, have a good one, man. Always good to hear from you there in Texarkana. Where my mom lives. Shout out to her. there, Texarkana. I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for Texarkana. It's where my mom and dad both met there. So I have fond memories of that place. Arkansas side, Texas side. Pretty cool. Pretty cool place. All right. I think there's two sides to that theory there that you're talking about, because on one hand, you're just like, if they take Mike out, that messes up the whole game plan. But also his versatility that he has to be able to play, you know, to go to flip sides and things like that, where you're talking about if they have a game plan that's exotic where he can do different things, it's a lot harder for the teams to take him out of the game plan, because every single snap you have to figure out where he is. Now, there's that side. There's also T.J. Watt in Pittsburgh. He never changes sides, really. Actually, you know what? That's not actually true. They used to say that about him, but I saw him flipping all over the place in that game. He usually doesn't. He did, though, in this game. He was tough to stop. So I think that there's two ways. I think I've always been told that you just don't do it one way in the game. You just don't. Other than play a quarterback, you don't rotate. But for the most part, you know, are they going to blitz? Are they going to play zone? Are they going to do this? Are they going to run outside? Are they going to go throw it deep? Yes, you're going to do all of that, but you're not only going to do that. You have to mix it up a little bit. Let's take one more call before we can take a break here. Doc in Allentown, Pennsylvania.
Hey, Nick, how you doing?
Good. How are you, Doc?
Doing good. My son and I went to 3-0 this weekend. We were at the Pittsburgh game.
Awesome.
And it was great. We waited out the rain delay. And they were actually announcing on the weather that it was going to be until midnight before they could start it because of the lightning. And thank God that didn't happen.
True, thankfully.
But it was a great game. Almost had a heart attack when they had the fumble there at the end.
Oh, yeah.
But great play by Dak to get back on it. But I had just said to my question for you is, we brought back Zeke to be the short yardage, goal line, first down guy. And I said to him, why aren't we putting him in? And then Rico, who had a real good game up until that point, you know, and the Steeler guy made an unbelievable hit with his helmet right on the ball. I mean, it was that was just incredible. But still, I don't know why, you know, Zeke seems to be getting a lot of bad publicity, and I'm still a fan of his, and I think Rico's the number one. But you know, what do you think that they should use? Yeah. Zeke on those short yardage ones. And he has actually had a few good carries, including in the Giants game and the Steelers game, where that got called back because of penalties, which I think is our biggest problem right now, the penalties.
Sure. Yeah. They're still figuring that out. Thanks, Doc. I mean, you know, they're still figuring out what they're going to do with the running game. And you know, I think Rico looked like, you know, from that game and also the last couple now, he's sorting his take over as the lead back, and that's fine. I think there's still a role for another running back, short yardage, you know, and Zeke could have that. It's a new role for him. And, you know, short yardage situations, there's two sides to that. There's times where you want your bigger guy that, you know, if you have contact, he can still kind of, you know, carry himself into the end zone. But you also got to have the quickness to get there, too. You know, Tony Pollard, he's not the same. When he was the back, there were some people arguing, yeah, but he hits that hole quicker. That hole is there if he hits it, as opposed to the guy that's bigger and stronger that's not going to hit it as quick, but also will, you know, have a chance to maybe, you know, shed off that contract a little contact and get into the end zone. So, you know, I think that they're not afraid to use either one. I mean, in that drive, in that game-winning drive, Zeke did have a first down carry on third and one and got a first down. So they're using them both. And Lipke, there's some talk about, you know, using him as well. So they're doing all of it, actually, right now. All right, let's take a break here on Cowboys Storyline, and we'll be right back to take more questions and text messages when we return.
Cowboys fans, when it comes to navigating the ever-changing world of tax, your business needs a partner it can trust to tackle even your biggest tax challenges. Ryan is the largest firm in the world dedicated exclusively to business taxes. Our team of tax professionals has local expertise in all areas of tax and can help you uncover savings opportunities you didn't know you had. Learn more about how Ryan can improve your overall corporate tax performance by visiting ryan.com. Ryan, the official tax partner of the Dallas Cowboys.
Hey y'all, Matt Pittman of Meat Church here. With football season kicking off, I'm already gearing up to bring the smoker back to AT&T Stadium for some epic tailgates. But with that Texas heat, it's crucial to keep my beer hand cramping cold. That's where Yeti's insulated Colster can cooler comes in clutch. This year, you can even get them with the iconic star engraved on the side. Licensed Yeti Cowboys gear is now available at stadium pro shops, concessions, and on yeti.com. Check it out today. Yeti, official cooler and drinkware of the Dallas Cowboys.
We got big personalities. We got big hair, big belt buckles. We got fans all across this big state and enemies in every other one. We even got a big star on the 50-yard line. Smirnoff knows football is a wee thing, an experience that is best enjoyed together. With good drinks and good folks home or away, we rally together, we cry together, and we always rally cry together because, most of all, we got big love for them boys. Smirnoff, we do game days. Please drink responsibly.
Back to Cowboys Storyline.
Monster Jam returns to Arlington. Head to AT&T Stadium on Saturday, October 26th. Watch four Marvel Monster Jam trucks make their Arlington debut. Tickets on sale now at SeatGeek.com, the official ticketing partner of AT&T Stadium. All right, welcome back to Cowboys Storyline. We are right in the middle of this show, getting a chance to talk to the all Cowboy Nations from all over the place. We've got messages on text line questions, which I want to throw one of those in there as well before we get back to the phone lines, though. But the lines, we do have an open line, I believe, 888-855-2297. First, I want to hit a text question. This is from RDJ in New Jersey. Says, good morning, Storyline. He said, I just wanted to acknowledge Hunter Lipke. This is a football player who in the last five games has done nothing but make plays with and without the ball. True. I mean, it just keeps going, you know, every single day. I actually told him about the nickname that I gave him. He liked it, I think. I called him Thanksgiving because every time you put everything on his plate, he just eats it. You just keep adding stuff to the plate, just like you would on Thanksgiving. You know, he's not going to be telling a lot of jokes. That's not his thing. I mean, he's kind of, you know, mild mannered guy. Kind of, you know, maybe he does. Maybe, you know, outside the locker room or whatever. But he's pretty serious minded dude. And but he just gets it done. And you know, you got to be careful with players like that, where you're like, just keep giving him the ball, just keep giving him things, because you know he's not. I don't think he's the lead back. I think he can carry it every now and again, but you know he doesn't have that open field speed. He's not going to do that. That's not what you want. But he's a H-back. I mean, he's a classic H-back. He can be a tight end. He can be a runner. The Cowboys really haven't had a player like this in a while. And don't say Darryl Johnston, because that's not really the type of player. Darryl Johnston was a fullback. He was a fullback. Now, he could catch it out of the backfield. He did that. Didn't really run it that much. Lipke's a little bit – he's a lot different, in my opinion, than him. But, man, he had a great play in the game. I actually almost got in trouble in the press box, because you're not really supposed to have outbursts, you know. But – for some reason, if y'all remember the old on primetime, they would watch ESPN primetime with Chris Berman would do that. When every time Mike Allstott would get the ball, he would just like, well, I did that in the middle of the press box when there was a screen. It was at the end of the game. There's a screen to Lipke and he's running down, and I'm doing that in the press box. So gotta watch out for that. But you know, then again, maybe those rules are changed a little bit. We keep putting our Spanish broadcast in the press box, and they don't tone it down. Victor Villalba and that crew. So there's, you know, there's outbursts all the time in the press box. Makes it fun. All right, let's go to the phone lines here. Dylan, Northport, Florida. Dylan, what's up, man?
Hey, Nick, how's it going?
How are you?
I'm all right. Called last week, talked about what do we got to do to get away from these slants and curls open the pass game, and we said chicken or egg. You got to run the ball, I think, right? And it showed this week. Yep. Dallas ran the ball well. Steelers had to commit resources. I haven't watched the All-22. Probably won't get a chance to watch it this week with the storm. But we saw live, I saw countless times where the Steelers were stacking the box. And I mean, just the passing chart here, Dak had four passes past 10 yards against the Giants. He had 10 against the Steelers. So we put more balls downfield. You saw Rico get a touchdown pass off of one of those. And Rico ran really well, man. I'm excited about him and what he can do moving forward. One moment he had, unfortunately, was the fumble.
Yeah.
And that play bothered me a little bit because you mentioned Hunter Lipke. Hunter Lipke cleared a nice path for him. He just needed an extra half of a second patience to just follow him, and it's basically a walk-in touchdown. But other than that, you know, Rico displayed a really good vision, which he struggled with for the season so far,
right.
And I thought he looked really great. I do want to give you my score prediction, too. I think this will be probably my last call for the week. I'll be on lockdown here. Very early score prediction, so this is subject to change. But as of right now, I'll say the Lions 31-24 because I just – being the Steelers is one thing, and it was a really good win. It's a tough team. I think the Lions just have a crap ton of talent, running back-wise, receiver-wise. There's so many ways they can beat you. Dallas is still dealing with injuries, and I think Dallas will compete offensively. I just think the Lions running game is going to be a little bit too much this week.
Yeah. It'll be a tough matchup for sure. Dylan, you guys be safe over there. The most important thing is not about the Lions game, the Steelers game, Rico fumbling, all that. You guys be safe there with the hurricane for sure. And I appreciate you taking some time to call in. So,
all right, thanks, Nick. Have a good one.
You too. Man, you know, it's a different world sometimes. And just thinking about, you know, extra things that are out there. You know, this is just football. This is just, we're just talking, you know, Cowboys and Steelers, Cowboys and Lions. But I know you guys have, you know, real life that happens. And I've heard people say, you know, sometimes this is a type of show, and all of our podcasts are the type of podcasts that can kind of get your mind off of things. And if that helps, then I certainly appreciate it. But the biggest thing is you guys stay safe. That's the second reference we've had in this show about the hurricanes. And you know, sometimes we take it for granted here. Everybody's got different things that they deal with, obviously. But we don't really – Texas – well, these Dallas doesn't deal with hurricanes. Houston does, but not so much here. But still, it's nothing that I've actually been involved in before, and it's a scary situation for sure. You guys be safe out there. All right, Michael in Bowling Green, Kentucky is next. Michael.
Hey, how you doing today?
Good. How are you?
I'm pretty good.
All right.
You know, I think at the end of the season, I think we're going to look back on this Pittsburgh game and say that that was the game that changed our season. I think we're going to come out on the other side of this game better than we were coming into it. I think we figured some stuff out.
You know, that those are things that you do. Like you said, at the end of the season, you can go back and do that. And there have been games like that. I've got some in mind that I remember you can look at and go, you know, that game changed everything. And this could be one of them because of how they had to win and who they had to win with. But go ahead with your other questions or points.
I just got a quick question about, can you just tell a story about Travis Frederick.
Okay.
That's all I got.
All right. Story. That's what storyline is, because it's story time as well. Travis Frederick. You know, the thing about him, I mean, I can't really think of a ton of stories off the bat, but I do remember when he was first drafted. Now, when he was drafted, he hurt some feelings, when we did our draft show, they didn't have him. They didn't have him getting picked first overall or first round. And I think it hurt a lot of feelings from fans too. Nobody wants to draft a center in the first round, but especially they had moved back from like 19 to 32. And so picked up a third round pick in the process. It just wasn't a sexy pick. I mean, nobody from a lineman from Wisconsin is not going to be. And so, what a great pick it was. And it was the second of three in a 4-year span there. Tyron Smith, then Frederick, and then Zach Martin, all in that, like a 4 years there, to really turn that offensive line around. The thing I just remember about him, like I had this visual at training camp of he would get like in a 1-on-1 drill. He would get beat like for the first like half second, you know, and you're like, oh man, he's about to get pancaked. But then he could just anchor down. He just knew how to kind of just get his body just right where he would just anchor and then just stop. It would just stop the whole process. And then you think this defensive tackle, I can't even think of somebody like an Antoine Woods or somebody like, oh, look at him. He's about to beat Frederick. And then he would just stop. He was so good at that. Knew how to put his hands in the right place, leverage. Really great player. And it's unfortunate that his career was cut short. But he's one of those that'll go down as one of the best centers, in my opinion, one of the best centers of all time. All right, let's go back to the line here. Irwin in Denver. It's been a while. Irwin, what's up, man?
Hey, what's going on, Nick? How you doing?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing great. Doing great. Hey, just a couple of things. I agreed with one of the guys who called in earlier about Micah Parsons. Like, I just want to get your thoughts on that. I remember watching Lawrence Taylor play, and he was like one of those players that would absolutely destroy a game. And yeah. I don't recall teams really scheming him and taking him out of games as good as he was. Mm-hmm. And then the other thing I want to ask you about or make a comment, I really think that Turpin and Tolbert need to be in that starting lineup. I mean, it's obvious that Turpin brings great speed to the wide receiver part. And I just think that Tolbert has elevated himself above Cooks. Cooks being an older receiver now, and I just think that he's ready to take that spot. And I just wanted to get your thoughts on those, and I'll let you go, and thanks for taking my call.
All right, thank you. First of all, starting lineup, it's not like it used to be. They're all going to play. Like, they're all – it doesn't matter who's – this isn't the Super Bowl where they run – who gets to run out of the tunnel and get their name called. I mean, it's not so much like that. I'm looking at – Hunter Lipke was a starter, in the game. I'm looking at the starting lineup. He started with Dowdle just because that's the package that they used. So they're going to play. I mean, when Cooks comes back, they're still going to use Turpin and Tolbert. So who's the starter? Who gets all the reps? I mean, it's a little irrelevant because they're all in that. I mean, CD's one guy, one starter, and then you're going to see Tolbert in there a lot. You'll see Turpin. So I get your point. Your point is they need to play a little bit more, and maybe even more than Cooks when he comes back. Let's see how that goes. I'm not ready to just put Cooks down because I saw this last year too. Last year it was a slow start. I don't think they were using him correctly, and I don't think they feel like they're using him correctly. This happened last year. Then they said this isn't his routes. These aren't the plays that make him a dynamic receiver. Let's get him down the field. Let's get him crossing the field. Once they started to do that, you saw a much better football player last year. I mean, by the end of the year, Cooks was really, really good. So I think they got to make sure and get back to that. He can still be a weapon for them. Same with Turpin, Tolbert. They just got to use him in the right way. And so I don't think it's a problem. This isn't, like I said, this isn't quarterback where you have to make a decision. If they're good and they're talented, there can be a role for them. As for Micah, we'll see how he comes back and what they do with him. They're still figuring that out. Zimmer's still, learning on where to put him, where to put all of these guys. What does Overshown do best? How can he have an exotic role in there too? So there's a lot of different ways to figure that out. All right, let's take a break here on Cowboy Storyline. We'll come back with a few more calls. Be right back.
Discover Aiden, the official luggage partner of the Dallas Cowboys and Dallas Cowboys cheerleaders. Known for top-tier engineering and craftsmanship, Aiden offers more than just bags. Originating from Australia and designed in New York, it merges fashion, design, and culture. Used by Dallas Cowboys players, staff, and the entire organization, Aiden provides style and functionality for all travelers. Visit AidenTheBrand.com and use code AidenXCowboys for 25% off your purchase. Travel like your favorite stars with Aiden.
Altec Lansing has been perfecting sound since 1927, bringing you decades of audio excellence to elevate your Dallas Cowboys tailgate ritual. Equip your next pregame with the Sound Rover 180 with 6 hours of playtime, built-in microphone, multicolor light modes, and a rugged exterior that's built to last. Visit AltecLansing.com/Cowboys15 for 15% off your Sound Rover 180. That's AltecLansing.com/Cowboys15 for 15% off. Altec Lansing, official audio partner of the Dallas Cowboys.
Back to Cowboys Storyline.
Stay connected with the Dallas Cowboys on your connected TV. Catch up on all Cowboys content like player interviews, weekly TV shows, podcasts, docuseries such as Deep Blue, and much more. Download the Cowboys Now app on Amazon Fire, Roku, and Apple TV. Welcome back to Cowboys Storyline here. I am Nick Eatman. We got a few more minutes to go on this show. We're going to start with, we're going to get back to the phone lines with Chris. He's in Saratoga Springs, New York. Chris, what's up, bud?
Hey, Nick. How's it going?
Good. How are you?
Good. I was going to talk again about the Brandon Cooks thing, but you just handled that for me. So
what's your thought? How about what's your thought on that?
I mean, I spoke to you last week online about it, and his yards per separation were terrible.
Yeah.
But maybe that had to do with his knee. And I wanted to give these young guys a chance, and Tolbert stepped up huge.
Yeah, he did.
This week. That's my thought on that, and I'm glad they got the young guys. And I saw Ryan Flannery in there. He didn't get any catches, but, I mean, he was in there a bunch, which was good to see him on the field.
Yeah. Yeah.
My other thought is, I actually want your thought on Tyler Smith. Unbelievable that he can just move from left guard to left tackle and hold it down like he did. And I just think, I mean, he might be better at left tackle. Our team might be better at having him at left tackle and having the rookie just sit and learn a little bit and have Tyler Bass there at that left guard position, because they looked really good when he came in there.
Yeah. It's yes. Yeah. I mean, that's a dilemma. Thanks for the call, Chris. Appreciate that. I mean, I said this yesterday, and you know, Tyler Guyton, fortunately, he's kind of day to day. Like, he has a chance to play in this game against the Lions. So his injury is not as serious, obviously, as Marshawn Nealon, who's going to be out for a few weeks here. Probably going to go to IR. So at this point, I would just stop calling people defensive ends. Just call them outside linebackers, and then therefore, if you put a defensive end tag on them, they're getting hurt. That's just the way it's going here. But to Tyler's, to your point on Tyler Smith, it's phenomenal what he did in the game. This it's not easy to just say, just move out there. I've seen Zach Martin. Zach Martin's a team player. He can play right tackle. I saw him in a press conference one time a couple years ago when they were sort of moving that, and they said, you know, what are your thoughts on that? And he said, I'm a right guard. And they're like, yeah, but you know, you have the ability, you know, if you need it. He said, I'm a guard. I'm like, okay, it matters. It's a difference. It's a difference between tackle and guard. You guys know that. I'm not telling you something you don't know. I'm just trying to point out that when that happens and he plays guard, left guard in the game, and moves out to tackle with no practice and does that, that's an impressive move. And it's unbelievable what he's been able to do. I don't think it gets mentioned enough. Just how remarkable that is. Tyler Guyton needs to play to get better. But you're right. Right now in this game against the Lions, who's your best players? Maybe it is T.J. Bass at left guard and Tyler Smith at left tackle. I know the Cowboys don't want to do it, but it's the best for your football team. You know, so and that's what they're trying to do is win games. All right, Gavin, Oklahoma City, what's up, bud?
Hey, Nick, I'm gonna keep it brief today. I just got a couple things for you. My first thought, and it is just a thought, so feel free to shoot it down. Is
your thought?
I was I was wondering how you feel about it though. So I personally think that maybe, with our star players being out, or some of our star players being out, seeing their backups come in and put forth full effort and really stop that run game and make some plays, I was wondering if you think that maybe could motivate them when they come back to, like, I don't know, perform better. And I feel like I know what your reply would be to that. If playing for the Dallas Cowboys and making money and winning games doesn't motivate you enough, then I don't think anything will. But I don't know. I just sometimes when I watch Micah in particular, and don't get me wrong, I love Micah Parsons, I feel like on first and second down, especially when they run the ball, he doesn't show as much effort as some of these younger, hungry guys might be showing.
Yeah.
And the other thing I got for you, and I'll just listen to you talk, is I usually don't call in multiple times a week, and I probably won't later in the week, but I think the odds are way against us in Detroit, but you always ask the fans what they think we could do to win a game. I think in this particular game, you're going to have to really out-scheme Detroit as a coaching staff, and everybody's going to have to give 100% effort on every play because it's going to be a tough one.
Yeah,
and
this is tough.
I think falling to 0-3 at home would be kind of devastating, even if 3-3 isn't the end of the world. But with that, I'll hang up, and thanks for taking my call.
All right, thanks. Well, it would be devastating if you weren't playing well on the road. I mean, you know, you count on winning games at home. You don't count on winning all your road games like that. But this is the way this league is. This way this team is, you know. Baltimore is a really good team. I mean, Baltimore is really, really good. And I think Detroit is too. And I don't know about the Saints. The Saints are... They were good that day, but I don't know how good they are. They're better than they were. So, you know, I can't look at it falling 0-3 at home. I mean, that's just kind of the way it is. You've got to just keep – I said this all for when the schedule came out. Just keep your head above water here in these first 7 or 8 games. Because then after that, you might get on a chance to start winning some games. But – then again, the schedule, it looks totally different than it was. I mean, at San Francisco doesn't look as tough as it usually is. We'll see. It'll be a tough game, but I'm just saying, with McCaffrey not there right now, we'll see what happens with him. At Washington looks a lot tougher than it did. Washington is much better now. So it's hard to look like that, you know, too far ahead. Your point real quick about Micah Parsons, you know, that's a slippery slope when you're talking about, you know, guys getting hurt and they motivate him and all that. I think it's a mindset for the entire team of, you know, yes, we need you guys back. You guys are our stars. We need you back. But this team's going to fight. They're going to hold down the fort without you. And these guys that we're pulling off the practice squad that you can barely even pronounce their names, Oruwariye and all that, is going to come in and he's going to step up. And Carl Lawson's going to step up. And Chauncey Golston's going to move from tackle to end. And Mozzie Smith's going to play well. And Linval Joseph's going to turn back the clock like it's 5-6 years ago and bull rush his way up to the center of the quarterback and all that. I mean, these guys are just going to ball out and play. So come on back. Come back when you can, you know, hopefully sooner than later, but no one's going to roll over, you know, and I think that's kind of the mindset. And maybe they come back, it rejuvenates everyone. We saw it when Dak went out. They rallied around Cooper Rush. Dak came back. They took it to another level, too. So that might be the case. Let's hope that that's the case when he does come back. We got one more caller here, Michael, Mississippi. What's up, man?
Hey, Rookie Mike, Nick, is what they call me.
Rookie Mike, all right.
Rookie Mike. I'm a huge fan. Never called in before. First time caller. I bought your book. Love it, by the way.
There we go. Thank you so much. I appreciate that. Thank you for buying the book.
Yeah, I actually wanted to defend Jerry Jones a little bit on this call.
All right.
I don't know if you've seen it, but at the end of the game, when Dak threw the winning touchdown, they showed him up in the press box, and he was emotional. You know, he was crying. And it's like all the fans say he don't care about winning. And, you know, he's all he cares about is making money. Even media says it. And I just really want to give a shout-out to him. If he's crying in the press box, he obviously cares about winning.
Yeah. Well.
So – I don't know if you've seen that.
Yeah, I've seen that. I've seen him. I mean, he gets emotional, you know, about some of those situations. That game was an emotional game. Just the people that say that they've never met him, they don't know him. If people really think Jerry doesn't want to win, then they don't know who he is and what he's about. It's just easy to just – it's low-hanging fruit just to kind of say that. Sounds good. People are going to think, oh, yeah, well, you're really critical on the Cowboys. But those people don't know. They honestly don't know if they really, really think Jerry's not trying to win. That's ridiculous. But sorry, Michael. We're pressed up against it. You got one more point or question?
Well, yeah, I was just going to say, you know, we're always favored to go to the Super Bowl and everything, and everybody's always talking about that. Hey, let's play this underdog role. It's just – I ain't giving up on it. We got 17 games, and we got a hard schedule coming up. Like you said, everybody's stepping up. They know they got to step up. We got players coming back. So let's just have them saying we're going to lose all these games, and let's see what happens.
All right. All right. I appreciate it. Thanks, Michael. You know, that is what it's just the mindset of expectations. This doesn't look like a 12-5 type team. Then again, 12-5 didn't get you where you really wanted to go. This is going to be a different type of team. This is a different season. Making the playoffs for this team, I think, would be really, really a big accomplishment, especially with all these injuries. They're just fighting through it right now. But you know, it's going to be a challenge. But you keep giving yourself a chance. Just give yourself a chance. Figure out a way to run the ball. Figure out a way to stop the ball. CD's going to be making plays. He'll be making some plays in the second half of games. I don't know what's happening there, but I'm sure they'll get that thing turned around. You got enough superstars. You got guys coming back. Just got to keep fighting. And that's what they did in that game. I think that's what they're going to continue to do. Guys, it was fun talking to you guys today. Had a lot of fun. We'll do it again tomorrow like we always do at 10 a.m. Central Time on Cowboys Storyline. So for Chris Beam, I'm Nick Eatman. We will see you next time on The Storyline.
This has been a production of DallasCowboys.com and the Dallas Cowboys Football Club.
How about this, Cowboys? Yeah!